Welcome to Gulfstream Park. It is February 14th. Happy Valentine's Day. Christina Bosanac is here with Stephen Skaggs. We got a nice, lovely day to go with, you know, it's a big day, Valentine's Day here in the States.
Right. Happy Valentine's Day.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was a little, it was raining yesterday. All our races were off the grass, but it dried out towards the end of yesterday. I think the course, a little moisture in it, but there was enough wind that I think we're probably looking at fast and firm.
You know, Stephen, just before we get into any of the races, in terms of how the track was playing yesterday, it was interesting because early on it seems like horses were closing and coming from off the pace. We had a couple of in there that also were showing speed, but what was your perception of how the day played?
You know, I went into it, Christina, thinking that speed in the rail would be good. I thought there would be a path on the fence, and I handicapped that way, and later in the card, it seemed like early, yes, they were coming from out of it, so I was wrong, and then I adjusted playing horses that were coming from out of it, and then speed started winning the later races, so I was off, but that's Gulfstream Park for you. You got to follow it from beginning to end.
Yeah, and right now the track is listed as fast and the turf course as good, and we got a 10 race card and highlighted by the 20-cent Rainbow Six carryover, just a tick under $700,000. That does start in race five, but before we get into all of that, Stephen, just a quick look ahead to this weekend to a couple of graded stakes. We have the MacDarmida, it's a grade two event on the turf, Twilight Eclipse. Really nice horse, graded stakes winner. He won here at Gulfstream last year. He won a couple of, he was second in a couple of grade ones up in New York. What I'm really interested in, just to get your opinion on, is Alpha. Alpha wins the Traverse, grade one winner. He also won the Woodward, but they're trying him on the turf. Now, his pedigree doesn't necessarily particularly scream turf from the stallion perspective, but what do you think about from the dam side?
Well, he's out of a Machiavellian mare, so I think grass won't be a problem. And is his second in by Nijinsky? I'm not positive. I think he does have a sneaky grass pedigree. And being by Bernardini, who's by AP Indy, I don't think the distance should bother him. And Alpha's got a little speed to him. He might control the race getting on the grass for the first time.
And Alpha, as Stephen just mentioned, is by Bernardini. The mare is actually a Nijinsky mare. Yeah, very grassy family. But, you know, it seems like maybe he will take to the turf. And if he does, you know, if he can convert his dirt form to the turf, that should be pretty interesting to see. Also, we've got the fillies and mares. And as we mentioned, the grade three, the very one. And Jazz is a horse that I'm interested in. She's from the Tom Albertrani barn. She hasn't raced since August. There's been, you know, nothing really majorly wrong. Tom Albertrani was saying there's nothing majorly wrong. They just, you know, a couple of races didn't go and, you know, some delays. But she's out of a world record mare, cost $10.5 million at the sales. And so, you know, she's an interesting horse to watch in there.
It'd be nice for Darla to get some of the dividends back and get that grade three. A horse that I'm interested in is Preferential, a Judmon horse that actually won a mile and a half race at Keene. It might have been a mile and three eighths. It was a mile and three eighths or mile and a half, but another three-turn horse to look out. And Preferential is actually training really well, and she's from the family of Star Former, who we had successful doing marathons down here at Gulfstream last winter.
Left a message, who schooled here just yesterday. She looked really great out there. And also Shanaki, a couple of horses that are now with Tom Proctor. At least Shanaki now is with Tom Proctor. So a couple of interesting, pretty competitive race, it looks like.
Right.
And on to, we'll just jump into today's card. We do have a 10 race card on tap. And we kick off. Race one is 6 furlongs on the main track. It is a 12.5 maiden claiming event. There is a scratch, number two, the Coolchi, and number six, Tangible Assets, gets blinkers on for the first time. My top selection in here, I went with number five, Optionality, from the Jorge Navarro barn, and just a nose second last time, and that was a tough beat.
Right, I actually thought he won the race, but my eyes deceived me. This is a horse that's 0 for 16, a very difficult proposition to bet on this horse, but I'm with you. Jorge Navarro got it for the first time off Mike Maker last time, and that was the horse's almost his lifetime best. He ran a 63 buyer that day. That beats this field, so if you're brave enough to bet on a horse that's 0 for 16, I think today is finally the day for Optionality.
And moving on to the second race on the card, which is a 25,000 maiden claiming event. 7.5 furlongs on the turf course. There is a scratch number 6, Union Square. And that race kicks off the early pick four. And my top selection, I went with number 8, Lloyd Harbor. And coming into this off of a couple of on-the-board finishes, including a third last time, January 26th, took money that day and at this level.
Right. I went with the 5, Alguna, a filly by Any Given Saturday out of a Cozine mare. Should handle the grass fine. Has run on the turf 7 times with 1 second and 3/3. I'm forgiving this horse's last race. The winner was looked like Lone Speed that day, party starter from the Michael Matz barn. She just walked around there. I'm forgiving the last race. If this horse repeats some of the other efforts before the most recent race, that puts her right there. She's run a 64 buyer. That beats this field.
Moving on to the third race on the card, which is a 35,000 maiden claiming event. 6 furlongs on the main track, a scratch number 4, Bob's Grand Slam. And my top selection in there, I went with number 2, I Want More Candy. And probably going to be sharpened up with the addition of blinkers this time. And didn't show a whole lot in that debut, but I'm thinking the drop in class, also the addition of blinkers should help. And but I see that you went with a pretty fast filly, Coro Coro.
Right, and there's a caveat with this horse. I don't know if he'll get 6 furlongs. This horse will be on the lead. The horse started in open company, running in straight and maiden races. Looks like Rodolfo Garcia tried the horse in a state bred race, then ran him most recently in the maiden 50. Today, he's finally in for maiden 35. This horse, like I said, will have the lead. I know he'll get 5/8 of a mile, 6 furlongs, question mark. I'm hoping at the 8th pole he's about 5 in front. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, he's a pretty fast, he's a pretty quick horse. And in terms of speed, it looks like who's going to be up there with him?
Nobody. Yeah. I think he'll be probably 2, 3, 4 lengths in front. It's really up to Jonathan Gonzalez to do right by this horse.
Mm-hmm. On to the fourth race on the card, which is a starter optional claiming event with a claiming price of $16,000. It is 7 furlongs on the main track. Couple of scratches, number 6, Dream Maestro, and number 7, Evolution Rocks. And my top selection actually scratched out of there. So I ended up with Bernie the Maestro from the Mike Maker barn. Now, Stephen, those last two races, I think Bernie the Maestro is probably his best distance, not 9 furlongs. I think going shorter, probably about 7/8, maybe a mile. And if you look back to a couple of his races last fall, and now, mind you, one was at Indiana Downs, the other one was at Saratoga. He beat a very nice horse, actually the ill-fated Kaisha Electronica, who's a graded stakes winner himself. So I think the distance for him is a big story here, and I think those last two races at 9 furlongs, that was probably too far for him.
Right. Bernie the Maestro, 5/10 at the 7 furlong distance with 3 seconds. He is a specialist. And you mentioned the last race. He was facing Mucho Macho Man, multiple grade 1 winner. He tried chasing Mucho Macho Man instead of trying to maybe suck up second. So I think he ran 4th that day, but he was probably the 2nd best horse and just ran into a monster. So I'm with you. I ended up with the 5, Bernie the Maestro, as well. The 1, Good Time by All, will be the horse to beat if Bernie the Maestro were to lose. He faced Lee last time, and as we know, Lee came back and romped in the Dawn.
Oh, it's interesting to see is that you did mention Bernie the Maestro showed speed that day, probably not up front, not on the front end this time.
Well, that was going long, so yeah, I think he'll probably be coming off the pace a little bit today.
Okay, we're going to take a short break, and we'll come back and have a look at the 5th on the card that kicks off that Rainbow 6. There is a carryover of just under $700,000.
The OBS March two-year-old sale is the grade one source to the world, with undefeated juvenile champion Asia Express in Japan. Grade one juvenile stakes winners by Conquistadore, Secret Compass, and Bondholder. King's Bishop winner Capo Bastone, and Breeders' Cup Sprint winner Secret Circle in North America. Make plans to find your next grade one winner at the OBS selected two-year-old sale, March 10th and 11th. OBS, we measure success by performance.
ExpressBet brings you a whole new way to play the races. An easier, better way to wager on your favorite tracks. With a more streamlined interface or faster wagering. With more handicapping insights from our world-class experts. With more racetracks, nearly 200 to choose from. And with your personalized multi-view wagering screen, your tracks, your wager pad, and your video are all on one page. It's simply the best way to play the races. Your way. Welcome to ExpressBet. Your way to play.
We're back at Gulfstream Park. We're going to have a look at the fifth race on today's card that kicks off the 20-cent Rainbow Six, just at about $700,000. And it is a mile on the turf course, and it is a $25,000 starter optional claiming event. And my top selection, number two, Hey Leroy. And coming into this off of a pretty good second-place effort, that was behind a horse named Mr. Online. Mr. Online won the El Prado. So there was no shame in defeat last time.
Right. Hey Leroy, since the switch to the turf, has gotten really good. This horse is 2-for-4 on the grass with the second. And you see he's the horse, the 12, with the white face way out of. But he runs right by these horses, and he was catching Mr. Online late. He ran giant last time.
Yeah, Mr. Online got the jump on him, and he really, really closed very, very well. And but I see that you went in a different direction here.
Well, I actually think the 3 Long Hunter is the horse to beat. I thought his last race was giant as well, but I went with the 1 Grip Hands. I'm hoping Julian Leper or Grand Motion are listening to this, because the last time this horse won was at Keeneland. They put him on the lead. He was in front by open lengths. If they employ these tactics here, because I don't think there's that much pace in the race, if Grip Hands can get the jump on Long Hunter early, he might be tough to get by. And he does have a win at Gulfstream Park, the 1 Grip Hands.
Yeah, I think this is a really competitive race. And even with all those scratches, I think that you probably still have to put up like maybe 2-3 horses on your ticket.
Yeah, I think 1-2-3 will get you through the race in whatever order you prefer.
Moving on to the sixth race on today's card, which kicks off the Pick 5. There is a scratch in number 5, Mr. Flexible. And the sixth race is a 62.50 claiming event, 6 furlongs on the main track. And my top selection in here, I went with number 9, Hard Tap. And this is a son of Tappet. Coming out of a pretty tough heat, he was in a 20,000 claiming event last time. If you go back a couple of starts, when he was in the Mike Maker barn, he won that day for 12,500.
Right. I went with the 7 Credit Voucher. This is first time Gammy Vasquez, and Gammy Vasquez has taken over the Frank Calabrese horses. This horse, he got off Angel Kiros last time, similar 62.50 race. This horse has some back numbers that makes him competitive here, and I like that the horse can pass. It looks like the 4 will have the early lead in this race, so I'm hoping the 7 can get by late.
You know, in terms of a trainer that, you know, many of us or some of us might not be familiar with and taking over that kind of operation, how do you play it? Do you automatically play it as you were before with the Frank Calabrese horses? Or, you know, what's your methodology?
It could be a wait, watch, and see type of approach, but I have to say that the first day on Wednesday that Gammy Vasquez took over, they had a winner right off the bat. So, you know, I think these horses are in spots where they're going to be competitive. The ownership seems to win at a 25, 30 to even 40% rate. They put these horses in spots where they can win, so I think Gammy Vasquez will continue the success that Kirk Zadie was having.
Yeah, definitely a Kirk, a group or team effort on their part, so one to watch. On to the seventh race on the card, which kicks off the late Pick 4. It is a 16,000 claiming event, 1 mile on the turf course. There's a jockey change, number 9, Carlos Olivero. And my top selection, it looks like we went in the same direction, number 6, Cantanero from the Wesley Ward barn, finding easier here, has a win over the turf course. Now, the race that he came out of last time, was interesting in that, you know, several of those horses, I think Romans Avenue just ran and didn't really show up as, you know, didn't run as well as I would have thought he would have. But he's coming out of some competitive heats.
Right. I went with this horse, Canzonero, trained by Wesley Ward. I like that this horse is dropping from 30 to 16. Wesley has this horse in the right spot. I like that he trusts Dylan Davis to get right back on this horse. This will be Dylan Davis's third time on this horse. He knows the horse well, and I like the weight break. So to me, it's just class drop angle.
Yeah, you. I see that you also used number 10, Valerie's Green Jet, that comes into also ran in the Slop 30,000 claiming event, and really didn't fare that well last time. But are you chalking that up to the sloppy track?
Well, the reason I use this horse is I think he'll be in front. I think he'll turn for home in front. So if this horse gets some slow fractions and makes it to the 8 pole in front, he might hold off Wesley's horse, but that's just because I think this horse holds a pace advantage, and he has, I think he'll be all right on the grass. He does have a second over it.
Speaking of pace advantage, I also see you use number 7, Defiant, and with from the Patricia Faro barn, and getting the services of Javier Castellano this time. Took money last time and did show some speed, and just tired in the late stages, but seems to be, like, you know, fits in this spot.
No, this is the exact spot. This horse is one pace, so he doesn't really have that burst. I think that he'll be running with the 10 horse, Valerie's Green Jet, and I think maybe the 10 will outburst the 7. I think the 7's a one pace sort. That's all.
Yeah. On to the 8th race on today's card. And it is a 62.5 allowance optional claiming event, 7 furlongs on the main track. And there is one scratch, number 6, and that's a Magic Mesa. And this race is interesting to me in that there's the return of a horse named Calistoga. That's number 2 from the Bill Mott barn. She won her first 2 starts, both of them at Gulfstream Park, very, very impressively. Came back and was 3rd at Churchill Downs in the 8 Bells, and that's a Grade 3 event. But those races, and this is the ladder of the 2 back March 7th, a very impressive horse. And if she can return to that form, Stephen, we might have like an open length winner again today.
Right. Calistoga will probably be 2-5 today. She looked like the real deal here last year. She won her first race, 6 furlongs, 109-3, came back, won the A other than like she was supposed to. We mentioned her race in the 8 Bells. That was a 13-horse war on Derby Day. And what I liked her coming out of that race, she proved that she could pass horses. In the first 2 races at Gulfstream last year, she was on the lead, controlled the race, had things her own way, was just too fast for who she was facing. So she faced tough horses in the Grade 3 8 Bells. And if you look, she was as far back as 10th. The reason I like her today, besides being the fastest horse in here, now that she can pass, I see the 5's going, the 1's going. There's actually a lot of speed in this race. She should set right off and get first jump.
And a couple of horses that I saw with the scratch of number 6, Magic Mesa, who's going to be showing speed. I think that helps a couple of the horses that you mentioned. Number 5, Sky Skier. I include this filly on my ticket, and she's a pretty quick filly from the now currently with Kelly Breen. But I think Calistoga is probably, in my opinion, and it sounds like yours too, probably the class of this field. And she's been training really well coming into this race.
If she's right, she's a single.
On to the 9th race on today's card, which is a 35,000 allowance optional claiming event. It is a 7/16 on the turf course, and there's a couple scratches. Number 7, Jean Surprise. Number 9, Jade's Rainbow. I was going to say Halo. I don't know why I'm thinking Halo. However, number 6, Naples Gold, my top selection in here from the Christophe Clement barn, 4-year-old filly by Langfuhr. She comes into this a pretty good effort, I thought, last time. A useful effort in her first start for Christophe. That was 9 furlongs.
Right. The important part of these staying races, these 3-turn races, is you want to save ground. If the rider can get over on the first turn, the second turn, it's going to be beneficial for the 3rd turn. So, to me, this is a trip race. I went with the 8 Clearbrook, trained by Bill Mott, daughter of Smart Strike out of a Danzig mare. She won first time out. And her last race, she went a mile and an eighth on the grass. You see, she was as far back as 10th. She ran fourth, got beaten four lengths. She's going to be the one that appreciates the added ground. And this is her third race in the form cycle, so I think you'll get her lifetime best today. And Mott has had really good luck with Johnny Velasquez this meet.
I see that you also used a horse named number 12 Win for Kitten from the Gary Contessa barn, and coming into this off of a win last time, but obviously likes the turf course.
Philly loves Gulfstream Park. She's 3-for-4 here with the second, and unlike most horses she's facing today, she is a multiple winner, three-time winner, so she knows how to get the job done while the rest of them don't have the killer instinct that she does. So, and we have all these kittens, Joy's winning down here anyway, so how can you leave one off?
Exactly right. And on to the final race on today's card, which is the 10th, is a 30,000 claiming event. It is a mile on the turf course, and scratch number 3, Quality Kitten, number 4, Lily Hannah, number 11, Rewarding Moment, and number 13, Put It In My Pocket, and my top selection in there, and it looks like we both went in the same direction, number 5, Raro from the Eddie Broom barn. And that last race, to me, is a toss. Well-beaten 10th on that particular occasion. But she's actually a very, very consistent mare.
Right. This filly has run at Gulfstream Park 5 times. 0 wins, but 2 seconds, 2/3. You look at her record on the grass, she's 2-for-7 with 4 seconds. And her last race is a toss. That was a stakes race on Claiming Crown Day. She drew the 9 hole of 11. She was 3 wide on the turns. And we get Paco Lopez, who's had the best luck with this filly.
I know that you also used number 2, Who's Mary's Daddy, and likely going to be showing speed in here. Pretty credible third place effort, beaten only a length the last time behind Win for Kitten. And I thought that was a pretty good effort. And in terms of the speed, there seems to be a little bit of some speed on the inside between number 1, Blackstone, and number 2, Who's Mary's Daddy.
Right. Those two are going to hook up early. You got to use Who's Mary's Daddy. Bobby DeBona just claimed this filly off Dale Romans, and he's 25% first off the claim. This filly does have a win over the grass, and the Scat Daddies love the turf here.
They sure do. Well, that's it for Stephen and myself. I will be back the rest of this afternoon with Mr. Ron Nicholas. Letty. Stephen, thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Good luck.
Big weekend here, and today we do have that 20-cent Rainbow Six, that carryover, just at about $700,000. Folks, that starts in race 5. Good luck.